Hi friends, today let us discuss the third part of transformer phasor diagrams. The main topics to be discussed in this video are concept of ideal transformer at no load, on load, practical transformer at no load and on load. Here we have considered two types of transformers. One is practical transformer and second one is ideal transformer. Ideal transformer is the transformer which has no losses. That means by using ideal transformer, we are going to study only the transformer action, not any other electrical things. So obviously it will give us the transformer action only, and we will discuss this ideal transformer at no load and on load also. Then we will come to practical transformer, where we need to incorporate all the losses one by one, so that how our transformer will look like. That means how our transformer's phasor diagram will look like. So that is the main idea of this video. Now let us move on to concept of ideal transformer. Concept of ideal transformer is obviously, as we discussed, the losses are negligible. So the main losses are core loss, resistive drop and reactance drop. So all these things will be neglected. And this is circuit diagram of ideal transformer. Transformer core is there. There are two windings. One is primary windings. Second one is secondary winding. Primary winding is having N1 turns and secondary winding is having N2 turns. Voltage V1 is applied. That is primary voltage. Because of that voltage, there is current flowing through the primary circuit, exciting current IE. Because of that exciting current, there is a flux flow induced in the transformer core, and that will circulate into the core. So there is an EMF induced in the primary coil E1. At the same time, there is other EMF induced at the secondary coil E2. If switch S is closed, there is a current flowing through load Z, and that current will be I2. Because of that current, the voltage drop will be V2. So this is total scenario, but here we need to observe something. The main observation should be primary voltage V1 and induced EMF E1 are equal, but they are opposite in nature according to Lenz's law. So we can conclude that V1 is equal to minus E1. Similarly, E2 and V2 are also equal, as there is no drop between them. So obviously we need to remember these two points. And one more point, that is purely assumption, we have assumed N1 and N2 are similar. N1 and N2 are same, so equal values. Of course the windings are not, they are not looking like that, but still we are assuming that part. And coming to the next thing, now we can discuss ideal transformer at no load. There are two circuits here. One is primary circuit, second one is secondary circuit. But before, in between these two, the common point is flux phi. Phi is taken as phi m sin omega t, as flux phi is the, as flux phi is, flux phi is just because of the exciting current IE, and IE is just because of the primary voltage V1, as V1 is sinusoidal in nature. So we have considered flux phi as sinusoidal in nature, flux phi m sin omega t. If we consider like this, we can draw with the straight line like this, and this is taken as the reference point. Flux phi has been drawn like this. Now we can draw IE very easily, as IE and flux phi are in phase to each other, as we haven't considered any core loss. According to EMF equation, we can conclude one more thing, that EMF induced EMF E1 and E2 are 90 degree lagging from flux phi. So this is the diagram for that. This is the line E1 is equal to E2. And as we have discussed earlier, V1 is equal to minus E1. So obviously V1 is 180 degree apart from E1 and E2. This is the total phasor diagram of ideal transformer at no load. Here only three equations are required. These are the three equations. With those equations only, we have made all these things. Next, coming to ideal transformer on load. Here also flux phi is there and IE is in phase with flux phi. EMF equation 90 degree lagging from flux phi E1 and E2. This is 90 degree lagging and V1 is equal to minus E1, exactly 180 degree apart from E1. Once this was done, as this is an ideal transformer, E1 and V2 are same, so we can write the same thing here. So E1 is equal to E2 is equal to V2. Now let us consider the inductive load. So current I2 is lagging V2 by 90 degree, sorry, by theta 2 angle. So this is I2, and I2 is the secondary current and which is an extra part from our circuits. So this part should be nullified or should be compensated by the other part in the primary, and that part is called I1 dash, the load component of the primary current, and that will be decided by the ampere turns of the primary and secondary. So those two should be equal. So according to this equation, I1 dash N1 is equal to I2 N2, we can decide I1 dash, and these two should be same, N1 and N2, and I1 and I2 are obviously opposite to each other. So we can draw I1 dash just opposite to I2, just like this, and the length should be same, as we have considered N1 and N2 are equal. So now I1 dash and IE are two components of primary current. So by taking the resultant of it, we can conclude that this is I1. I1 is the primary current here. Now this is practical transformer. Practical transformer is exactly same as the ideal transformer, but here we need to consider core loss, resistive drop and leakage flux. So here the leakage flux is shown in the diagram. Magnetization curve. Because of magnetization curve, and we have incorporated the core loss into our circuit, because of this thing, current, exciting current, is not in phase with the flux phi, and it is alpha degree ahead of flux phi, and the explanation for this is shown as diagrams here. Consider figure A. If current IE is given to any coil, there is flux induced in the coil, and that flux, if you keep on increasing IE, flux will keep on increasing linearly, but this is exponential in nature. But after this, if IE is reduced, your flux never be reduced in the same fashion, and it will follow in this fashion as shown in the figure A. Now I like to consider one part of this figure. The part is traveling from N to P. N to P. So at N, I like to explore the values of IE and flux phi. At N, the flux value is minus N and IE value is 0. Similarly, at P, the flux value is 0 and IE value is P. These things have been tabulated at the top. Now I like to draw sinusoidal waveforms for this fact. I like to draw exciting current first. I have drawn the exciting current. Now at IE equal to 0, the value of flux phi is minus N. So I put a point at minus N, and after some time at point P, the flux is 0. So at point P, I have marked 0. 0 means the flux wave is starting from this point. And my IE is already started at this point, and flux wave is starting from this point. Now I can say that there are these two are the waveforms. As the frequency is same, so these two are the waveforms, and I can say the angle between these two waves is hysteresis angle alpha. Now by seeing this waveform, we can easily conclude that the exciting current is alpha degree ahead of flux phi, and that fact has to be incorporated in our practical transformer at no load. Now let us see, flux phi is this, okay, EMF is 90 degree behind the flux phi, and V1 dash. Now here we like to consider V1 dash, which is equal to minus E1. Once this was done, now introducing the core loss, i.e. has to be drawn alpha degree ahead of flux phi, and we know IE is divided into two components. One is IC, first component is called IC, core loss component. Second component is IM, magnetizing component. This will be shown as phasor addition, IE is equal to IC plus IM, where IC is core loss current, IM is magnetizing current. Now introducing the resistive drop IER1, it is in phase with IE and starting from I1 dash, so it has to be drawn like this, IER1. After this we need to introduce the leakage reactance drop, and that will be IEX1, which is 90 degree ahead of IE, so it will be like this. Now the summation of V1 dash IER1 JIEX2 will give us V1. This is the main difference of practical transformer and ideal transformer. Here we need to consider all the losses. So the first loss is core loss, so alpha is incorporated. Second loss is resistive drop, so IER1. Third loss is reactance drop, so that is JIEX1. Now move on to practical transformer on load. Inductive load is there. Here same thing happens, flux phi, IE is there, alpha degree ahead of it, and it is divided into two parts, IC and IM. Next induced EMF 90 degree apart like this. Now we need to consider V1 dash is equal to minus E1. Now we need to consider V2. Here E1 and E2 are not fixed, so we can draw it as a dotted lines, that's better thing. Later the length will be decided, and this will be V1, V2. V2 is simply drawn with some lagging angle with E1 and E2, and I2 is having theta 2 lagging from V2, as it is, as we have considered inductive load. So this is theta 2. So after this we need to consider resistive drop in the secondary side. The drop is I2 R2. Next reactance drop 90 degree ahead of I2 or I2 R2. This is JX2 I2 X2. In the summation of V2, I2 R2, JI2 X2 will be E1 and E2. Now we got the length of E1 and E2, and that will be reflected in V1 dash. And here I2 is there. Yes, after this, because of I2, once the drops are incorporated, because of I2 there should be primary component I1 dash, and the resultant of I1 dash and IE will give us the primary current I1 now. And after this we need to incorporate the resistive drop of the primary, that is I1R1, and reactance drop, that is JI1X1, and finally V1 will be V1 dash plus I1R1 plus JI1X1. So this is complete explanation of practical transformer on load for inductive load. Now let us move on to other loads also. Capacitive load. Oh, this is theta 1, which is the primary power factor angle, which is the angle between V1 and I1. Yeah, next this would be the capacitive practical transformer on load for capacitive loads, and this is the diagram for it. And let me show you the resistive load also, and this is the diagram for that. So here what happened, simply V2 is considered somewhat left side to E1 and D2. Okay, that's an assumption. Now I2 is considered leading power factor of theta 2 from V2. Now the thing will be changed like this: I2, then I1 dash, and I1 dash and IE resultant of these two will give us I1. I1 R1 is in phase with I1, and J I1 X1 is 90 degree apart from I1 R1. So finally, this is V1. Similarly, in resistive load, V2 and I2 are in phase to each other. So obviously, I2 R2 is some more thing from V2 only, in phase with V2, and 90 degree apart from this, this is J I2 X2. And finally, your length of E1 and E2 will be decided. Then only you can draw V1 dash. That is the complete explanation of this phasor diagrams for ideal transformer at low, at on load and load, and practical transformer at no load and on load. If you like the video, please like it and share it, and kindly subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.